إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, brothers and sisters in the Deen of Islam. It is a great honor and a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be standing before you today. The message that we want to bring today is nothing more than a reminder to myself and to you, and hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, we will all benefit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He addresses us, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He says, Huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan minhum yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yu'allimuhum al-kitab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us and He tells us that it was He who sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an unlettered prophet, someone who couldn't read and someone who couldn't write. So obviously, by the address, we should also understand, and what we can take from this is that the fact that he couldn't read and the fact that he couldn't write, sometimes that would put you in a certain category of people of society today. When people cannot read and they cannot write, they are looked at in society as low, uneducated. Sometimes they are looked at as if they're no one. But my brothers and sisters in the Deen of Islam, there's something that we have to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses who He wants to guide, and He gives them what He needs, whoever He gives to, the benefit, or He gives them the tools to work with. The tool that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to work with was the Quran. And this is something that you and I both know is a miracle. It's a miracle because each and every one of us have been changed by this various book. In it, it has no discrepancies. There's no misguidance in this book. There's no lies. There's nothing that's ambiguous. This is the book that has been revealed to all of mankind. From the time it was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls everything out, when that hour, when that day comes, on a day like today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions, because the topic of what I want to bring today, based on the first of what I just recited, that He sent an unlettered prophet. Huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan minhum, a messenger. Yatlu alayhim ayatihi, to do what? He sent him with ayats, signs, revelation, to do what? Why you zakihim, why you alimuhum al-kitab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him with signs. Not only the signs, but He also taught him the hikmah of how for you and I to be able to take those signs to be able to guide us from point A to point B. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the hikmah, the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding and the best, most comprehensive way to be able to lead you and me out of the fire into the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The topic in general today is about how can we take the embodiment and the characteristic of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and apply that to our lives today. His life was an embodiment of simplicity. His life and his character was an embodiment of simplification. Many times and oftentimes do we have young Muslims and new Muslims or new people who come into the fold of Islam and they don't know where to start and they also don't know where they're going because they are not given the proper tools, they're not given the proper equipment, and they are not handled carefully so that they can acquire the best benefit out of what you and I have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has led each and every one of us away from the things that are displeasing to him, and he has guided us and instructed us to everything that is pleasing to him. For many of us, like myself and some of us in the crowd today, who weren't Muslim growing up or weren't acknowledging that we were Muslim, who came out of churches, who came out of synagogues maybe, or anything other than Islam and everything un-Islamic, when we came into the deen of Islam, there were some things and some requirements that many of us back in the day, we had to understand. Some of those things I want to share with you. Some of those things, number one, as a new Muslim, was that when we came into the deen of Islam, the first thing that happened was we had someone appointed for us. Appointed. This is a direct point towards what? Establishment. This is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this house, in this masjid, it is like a hospital. It is supposed to serve every single thing for you and me to be able to function as a Muslim. It is supposed to give us the tools to be equipped, to be fundamentally grounded in the basic requirements to be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that is comprehensive for you and me. Upon our entry into Islam, my brothers and sisters in the deen of Islam, as we were appointed certain things to do, some of the things that we were appointed to do that we had to do out of the gate was, number one, we had to learn purification. How often do we see some of our young ones or our elders, both young and old, 10, 15, 20 years down the line, who still cannot purify themselves properly? Because why? The starting point, when you first entered into the deen of Islam, it wasn't handled properly. And that is the job of you and me. If every one of us knows how to pray, if every one of us knows how to purify themselves, the basic requirements, then it is your job and my job to share this with your new brothers who come into the fold of Islam, or your young ones, to make sure that they are up on this stuff, that they understand the requirements, the basic requirements, just in order to function as a Muslim. These were some of the things that were appointed for us to do. Initially, out the gate, we had to learn these things, some minimal requirements. Why? So that we would be able to not be like robots. So that we would be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with value. So that we would be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that is according to the sunnah of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. In a way that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not in a way that we just want to make up. Not in a way that is haphazard. But this goes to management. How are we going to manage people coming into the fold of Islam? In the beginning and in the middle, until we put them in the grave, how are we going to manage their lives? Are we taking care of them? Are we looking out after them? Are we making sure that they have what you have? Because we're Muslim, and you should want those new brothers who come into the deen of Islam, or sisters, to have what you and I have. Remember, some of us came out of Kufa. So coming out of Kufa, there was times when we never even spoke Allah's name. There was times when we never even uttered the word Islam. There was times we didn't even say the word Muslim. We didn't even say these things. But now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken us out of that and given us something that none of us should want to ever give up. None of us. It all takes, it is all a direct hit on how are we managing the affairs of the Muslims. Because there are so many people nowadays that are exiting the fold of Islam because of lack of management. Exiting the fold of Islam because we're not handling them properly. We're not giving them the tools that they need to be able to function as a Muslim. It is our responsibility and our job to give them this. And if we don't know, then it is also our responsibility to go to the ones who know, no matter how old they are. It doesn't matter. If one of our children knows more Quran than us, and he's reached the age of discernment, then we line up behind him. We got to put pride to the side. We have to put pride to the side. And we have to start doing things that will bring us communal benefit as opposed to things that will keep us separated. Some of the things that we had to learn was like purification. It was also a requirement for some of us who first came into the deen of Islam to learn the last 10 or 17 ayats of Quran. I'm sorry, surahs of Quran. This is the basic requirement that it can be implemented anywhere you go, in any masajid. Basic requirements. That anybody who comes into the deen of Islam and they say shahada before you, remember this. This is also a test on you. Because if somebody stands before you and says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasulullah, and he doesn't know what his responsibilities to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, then it is on your shoulders as well as it is mine. Another thing we had to learn was when the salat came in and when the salat went out. We had to learn the times of salat. We had to learn the different names of salat. Specifically, it's not okay to just stand up and make movements to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we don't know what to say. We had to know what to say between different movements as we're making our salat to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would teach tashahud to the people who didn't know this. How many of us right now can say that your prayer is perfect? No one. None of us. So we can always go over this stuff, right? We can always rehearse this stuff, right? We can always go back to the drawing board. Why? Because it is a responsibility for us to stay connected to the fundamentals of what this deed is established upon. Because when we leave the fundamentals of Islam, then we have left Islam. Because Islam is fundamentally based on the things that you have to know in order to give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his due worship. And if we leave those things, then we're causing more harm than benefit. Another thing that we used to have to learn, ayatul kursi. Imagine this, new Muslims learning these things. The different phrases and what we had to say in our salat. And different du'as made during and after the salat. Abi Dawood, in his Sunan, he collected about 500,000 hadith. 500,000. I'm sorry. He collected about 500,000 hadith. But in his Sunan, he compressed it to about 4,000 and about 80 hadith. And he made a statement. And he's not the only one amongst the scholars that we know, or the muhaddithin that we know, that made this statement. He said, fiqh, it evolves around five of the ahadith that I have collected in my sunnah. Five. And remember, my brothers, we're talking about simplicity. We're talking about making things easy. Once you learn these basic fundamentals out of the gate, then it's required for us to know how to apply these things. But we can't give a new person or a young person a whole bunch. Because why? It will leave him just as fast as you give it to him if you try to cram it down their throats. We have to take knowledge and we have to take understanding step by step. Why? Is it because we say so? No. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, he says, "Inni utitu jawami al-kalim." Verily, I was given the ability to speak comprehensively. We have to be able to make it comprehensive to the people so that they can benefit. Of these five ahadith that Abi Dawood mentioned that Deen as a legal system evolved around, one of them, and you will find as I read it, from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, who said that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, he says, "Innama al-amalu binniyat wa innama likulli imrin ma nawa." This is not the whole hadith, of course, but this is a portion of the hadith to hammer home the point. This is one of the foundational hadiths. Why? Because he even Imam Shafi, he mentioned, he said that this hadith, it is a third of your deen. Or is it a third of all knowledge? In the Malamalu Biniyah. That your deeds or the actions depend upon the intentions of every person. And they will get the reward according to what they intend. This is something that it doesn't just touch one aspect of Islam, one aspect of fiqh. It says in this one hadith, it touches 70 branches of fiqh. You see? Comprehensive. Another hadith that Abi Dawood mentioned, or that he collected, or that he mentioned in the Sunan, and this is from Abu Sa'id Sa'd ibn Malik ibn Sinan al-Qudri, who said that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, he said, "La darar wa la dirar." He said, "Do not harm and do not be the cause of harm." The first one in the Malamalu Biniyat, the intentions has to be looked at in every single thing that we do. Everything. That's what I mean by summarizing this for the new people, the young people. We have to check our intentions when we come in the door, when we sit down, and when we leave. Our intentions has to be checked in the beginning, in the middle, and in the end. And then this next one, it says, "Do not harm and do not be a cause of harm." Think about this stuff, how wide this can be when we put this into practice, because we need something, we need advice that is going to be what? Practical. Something that we can implement right now. Which is the next hadith that he brings. The next hadith, and this is five that he said he collected, that these five, he says that deen as a system evolves around these hadith. And one of them, he says, "Inna halala bayyinun wa inna al-haram bayyinun." That the halal is clear and that the haram is clear. What lies in between that is doubt, and we stay away from that. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as I mentioned, "Huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan minhum yatlu 'alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakihim wa yu'allimuhum al-kitab wal hikmah." He is the one who taught us how to apply the deen of Islam in its proper perspective with hikmah. That was his job. That is our job. To simplify this for the new, the young, and the old. Because why? Deen is not meant to be hard. or a burden. It is meant to be easy because Allah gave this to us as a source of life to the heart and to our community. When will the time come, my brothers and sisters? When has the time come? Has our hearts not become affected by what you see on TV, in your neighborhoods, even in your own homes, the things that is taking place? Has not the time come that our hearts become affected by this? Are we not affected, or do we just look and we just turn away? We have to stop just looking and turning away and do something about it, and it starts right here in the hospital. Some of us, our job is like the paramedics. We can't perform heart surgery, but we can resuscitate and get you to the hospital so that the specialists, who are the scholars, can perform surgery on your hearts. But in order to be a paramedic, it requires you to know at least the basic fundamentals of what a paramedic has to do, so that we can resuscitate the dead heart with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the haram or the halal is clear, and the haram is clear. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected every single thing in our deen. That means that after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that on this day I perfected your way of life for you, that means anything coming after that, it is to be thrown in the garbage. The deen of Islam does not rest on your opinions or hearsay. It is called Allah, called Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and it is what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought. And that's it. And there's nothing else that's coming. If we're looking for something else, then we have been deceived. If we're searching for something else, if we're hoping for something else, then we have been deceived. Every single thing that you need is in the Quran. And every way of how to implement that is in the Sunnah. You cannot have Islam without the Sunnah. And you cannot have the Sunnah without Islam. They go hand in hand. Let us make sure that we don't throw either one of them away. The fourth hadith that he brings as a foundational hadith, he says, Ad-Dinu Nasiha. Ad-Dinu Nasiha. قلنا لمن قال ولكتابي ولرسولي ولأئمة المسلمين وأمّاتهم. That the deen is about what? Sincere advice. Sincere advice. Or sincerity to Allah and accepting His advice. It was said, to whom? Laman. Qala, he said, wali kitabihi, to the Quran, wali rasulihi, to the messenger, wala immatil muslimin, and to the leaders of the Muslim, and wa ammatihim, and to the Muslims in general. Ad-Dinu Nasiha. It is about advice, sincere advice, giving it and being willing to accept it. And lastly, the last hadith he came with was another hadith from Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, who said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions, "Ma nahaytukum anhu fajtanibu, wa ma amartukum bihi fa'atu minhu mastata'tum." فَإِنَّمَا أَحْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ كَفَرْتُمْ مَسَاءَلِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. That which I have forbidden you, abstain from it. And that which I have ordered you with, do as much of it as you are able. And also, he says, it was only the excessive questioning and disagreeing with their prophets that destroyed them before. Let us not be at odds with one another. Let us not be in disagreement with one another. Let us be upon oneness with Allah and His Prophet. Obedience to Allah and obedience to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And let us take care of the young ones. Let us take care of the old ones. Let us take care of the new when they come into the deen of Islam. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولك ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, والعصر إن الإنسان لا في خسر. Time is always declining. Always. If we had more time, then inshallah, we would go further into explaining some of these hadith that I brought with you today. But we don't. But the point I want to make is that those five hadith that I mentioned were five foundational hadith. Five. That all of, in the Sunan of Abi Dawud, that he mentioned that all of what he collected out of 4,080 hadith evolved around. Or as Islam, as a system, evolved around. Let us summarize and let us make plain and not difficult what is necessary to be made plain to the new Muslim, the old Muslim, and all of us as a whole. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the guidance, the tawfiq, to be able to take care of one another when we enter the fold of Islam, so that we don't find ourselves exiting the fold of Islam due to a lack of maintenance. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا لا تجعلنا فتنة للذين كفروا واغفر لنا ربنا إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب أقم الصلاة